So as thank you for introduction, Lionel. So I'm Alexander Dvornikov, and I'm working at the Laboratory for Fluorescence Dynamics. So we are developing some new methods for microscopy, advanced methods. And one of our projects is the, we call the DIVER, which stands for Deep Imaging Wear Emission Recovery. So the main goal of this project was to make some imaging system which would be capable to image at high resolution, like cellular resolution, submicron resolution in the very highly scattered media, such as, of course, we're targeting the biological tissues. So we made this microscope. This is the two-photon microscope, which pretty actually simple device in the contrary of the previous talk, which is very amazing and sophisticated system. We made it pretty simple, and the purpose of my talk today would be to show you how does it work. So this DIVER microscope can go pretty deep in turbid medium. As a goal, we set like to image in few millimeters depth. Also, this is the custom microscope, so it's offer very wide field of view. Sometimes you need to image big objects like on centimeter size. So with this microscope, it's pretty easy to do this. also this microscope has the FLIM capability, fluorescence lifetime imaging, which is in combination of enhanced imaging depth, is pretty powerful tool. And then we also realized that this microscope would be very good to do imaging with harmonic generations, like second and third harmonic, which is also very useful tools to image such objects like collagen fibers and cell membranes, lipid droplets. Also, we can do with this microscope hyperspectral imaging. Okay, let's see how does it work. So if we will look at the tissue properties, most of it, it's when the light interact with the scattering medium tissues, biological tissues, it will be scattered. Obviously, know that red light scattered less than blue light. So if we want to penetrate deeper, preferably we should use some red light or infrared, near infrared light. mostly the in biological tissue, light will be scattered because biological tissue don't really have much absorb molecules which may absorb this infrared light. Well, it's only like blood and melanin, they are pretty strong absorbers in practically all the region, but still we have the window between 600 and micron wavelengths, 600 nanometers and one micron, where the light tissue is pretty transparent for the light. So most it will be just scattering. And if we will use longer wavelengths, then this light also will penetrate potentially deeper inside the tissue. So as I said, this the method which we're using to image in deeper in scattering media is the two-photon microscope with some special detection system. So this is how the two-photon microscope in general works, right? We have the laser source which generate very fast pulses in the near infrared region. Then we have scanner, right? We focus the light, excitation light inside the sample. And once we have the very high intensity light in the focal point, what may happen, the infrared photons by itself cannot be absorbed by the tissue because they don't have enough energy. But if we have enough intensity in the focal point, then what may happen, two photons will combine together and the energy will be enough to excite the molecule to excited state. And then it will relax either by going to original state and the energy will go to the temperature, or it will emit fluorescence. And then if we will detect this fluorescence, and fluorescence will happen only in the tiny spot of the focal point because it has the square dependence on light intensity, which will decay out of focus very fast. So only tiny spot in the focal point will induce this two-photon fluorescence. Then if we will scan this point, usually it's like raster scanning in all the microscope, right? We will get the image, very high resolution image. And this is fluorescence then directed to the detector. And this is how we do imaging with two-photon microscopes. So let's take a look what the specifics when we use, when the medium is the highly scattering medium. So again, we focus the light, infrared light inside this scattering medium, and obviously it will scatter these excitation photons, right? We have photons will go all around the sample. Some photons will be not scattering, they will go directly to the focal point. These are so-called ballistic or unscattered photons. So what is important here, that only those straight ballistic photons will induce two-photon fluorescence in the focal point, because scattered photons, even they can go back to the focal point, but because they will travel longer distance than ballistic photons, they will be delayed in time. And to get two-photon process, we need these photons to meet not only in this space, but only in time. So these scattered photons, they will not participate in the two-photon process. But that means that even in highly scattered medium, because only ballistic photons will induce two-photon fluorescence, we still have very sharp, tiny focal point, which will be fluorescing. So then if we will scan this point, as usually we do in two-photon microscopes, we can get a very high resolution image, even in highly scattering medium. So let's see what could be the image depth limitations. So those ballistic photons, of course, they will be attenuated by the medium. And then deeper we go, then less of those photons will come to the focal point. It can be shown that those photons will decay, intensity of those ballistic photons will decay exponentially with the imaging depth. So then deeper we go, then less signal we will have. So of course, to compensate for this signal decay, we should increase the laser power. That's what we usually do when we want to image deeper. But at some energy level, if we will increase the laser light, it will be enough intensity of this excitation light to induce two-photon fluorescence at the surface of the sample. And then stronger and deeper we will go inside the sample, the signal at the focal point will decrease intensity. At some point, this out of focus fluorescence at the surface will start to mask our signal. And this is considered as one of the major factors which will limit your imaging depth in scattering medium. Another process what may happen in scattering in turbid medium is distortion of the wavefront. So because medium has some areas with different index of refractions, then the excitation photons, they will be deviated by those spots from the original optical path. So they will meet not exactly in the focal point, but the focal point or point spread function will be blurred. And that will in turn lead to the losing resolution of your images. To some extent, the technique called adaptive optics could be used to compensate for that effect. For example, if we have deformable mirror, which can manipulate the wavefront of the excitation beam, we can set it the way so that those excitation rays, they will meet at the focal point back, and so we can compensate for this loss of resolution. Okay, let's see, this is, we were talking about the excitation part. So now let's see how the conventional two-photon microscope works. So when we do excitation, two-photon excitation in this, particularly in this highly scattering medium, the photons, two-photon-induced fluorescent photons, will be then also scattered inside the sample. So conventional microscopes use the so-called epidetection system when these photons, fluorescence photons, collected by the same objective which is used for excitation, and then they are directed to detector. So you can see in these schematics, most of the photons, and these are because of its scattering medium, so those photons can go everywhere, exit samples in many directions. So only by these schematics, only a small portion of these fluorescent photons can be collected from the reasonably small area of the sample and also its certain acceptance angle of the objective. So most of the photons will be lost. And of course, then more sensitive detector you have, then more photons you can collect, these fluorescence photons, then deeper we can do imaging. So to methods was proposed to enhance this imaging depth by collecting those extra, you know, photons which otherwise will miss the objectives. For example, one method called total emission detection proposed to use the parabolic mirror around the objective. So this parabolic mirror direct reflect these otherwise missing photons back to detector. And this method was shown given a signal gain about few times dependent of the imaging depth. Another proposed method was using the ring of optical fibers around objectives. Same idea to pick up those photons which otherwise will miss the objective. And so this is also helping to collect more photons and this way to increase the signal a few times. So let's see what did we do in our diver method. So in the diver method, we proposed to use a very simple technique. So because those photons, fluorescence photons, are scattered all around the sample and then exit the surface technically everywhere at any angle, right? We proposed to use wide area detector. So once we use this wide area detector, so this detector, unlike the epidetection, may collect photons from the very wide area of the sample. Another thing in the diver detection method is to match the index of refraction from the sample to detector. This is important because scattering photons exit the sample at any directions, right? And if we have index gradient, like two between two medium, the border, we will have reflection. At certain angle, critical angle, we will have even total internal reflection. So those reflections on the borders, they will lead to lose a lot of photons this way. But once we match the index of refraction, so all, or at least we will minimize these losses on the due to reflections and photons which are reach the surface, wide area of the surface of the sample, will go to detector. This is just a simple demonstration of the index matching technique. So if we have, for example, a bunch of microscope slides and we'll try to look through them on some image, this image will appear pretty dark because of multiple reflections in the between the surfaces of the glass slides. But if we will, for example, fill these gaps, air gaps with water, then the image becoming much, much brighter. So these two principles of the diver detection method, use of wide area detector and matching of index of refraction, give us signal gain, depending of course on the imaging depth, by about three orders of magnitude as we measure it. And this method is pretty simple, as you can see, practically has no optic, very simple construction. Everybody can do it. So this is the detector construction, diver detector construction. So we cannot put, of course, the sample right on the photomultiplier. So we need to make some sort of interface for that, because we need to protect PMT. It's very sensitive to light device, so we don't want to blind it. So should be some sort of shutter. So what we do, we have this kind of photomultiplier tube with the area of 18 by 18 millimeters. So it's in some metal case. Then we attach the chamber, sealed chamber, to this photomultiplier. This chamber is filled with the liquid to match the index from the sample to the multiplier, photomultiplier. Inside this chamber, we have the filter wheel with a number of optical filters. Sometimes we want to separate fluorescence by color, right? It may come with different colors. Also, we have one position, just metal, so it serves as a shutter. Two filters here, BG39 filters, they serve as the windows in this chamber. Also, they are blocking the infrared light to penetrate to the photomultiplier tube, and they transmit the visible light, which is fluorescence. Okay, here is the schematic of this diver microscope. It's mainly, this is about detection, as you understand, but also we built the microscope, two photon microscope, which is we also call diver. Of course, it has the excitation laser source, which is pulsed femtosecond laser. Acoustic optic modulator is the device which we can use to attenuate the light, to manage the light intensity from the laser. Then, of course, we have XY scanner. We can also put this, we have in this system the deformable mirror to do adaptive optics technique. Scanning optics, because this is the custom-made microscope, we designed the scanning optics the way so we can get very wide field of view of the images. For example, with the objective, 10x objective, we can easily get the image of the size of 3 by 3 millimeters. Sometimes we want to image, you know, big samples like even centimeter size, so it's pretty easy then to tile reasonably big samples. So this microscope has the also epi detector, and this is the diver detector, which is placed on the XYZ positioning stage. Also, it is coupled with the FLIM box, which allow us to do fluorescence lifetime imaging with this microscope. And this is very good feature actually of this microscope, because in combination of the extended imaging depth, and we can do then 3D reconstruction of images and color them according to the lifetime, features according to the lifetime. Okay, here's an example of such a diver detector. It can be made in the shape, so we can just plug it in the standard microscope stage. So it can be used even with the commercial microscopes. So we have here just want to show you this diver family. We have such a detector at, of course, LFD at UCI. Then one such detector University of Colorado has right now, one in Georgetown University. And right now Lionel is building this system. So unfortunately, sometime he will also have this diver microscope. Here I want to show you the very simple experiment we did to estimate the efficiency of this diver detector. So we did a very simple experiment. We were using the sample with scattering sample with embedded fluorescent beads, and we imaged them with the diver detector. And at the same time, we were imaging same beads with the EPI detector. And then we took the ratio of the signal measured with EPI detector to diver detector and plotted as a function of the imaging depth. So you can see that if we have transparent medium, then more or less this ratio is flat. Even in transparent media diver with imaging depth behave a little bit better. We explain this by the fact that when we go close to the detector, the efficient numerical aperture of the diver detector increasing while the EPI detector has the same numerical aperture. And that leads that diver may pick up with depth, with increasing imaging depth, little bit more photons than the EPI detector, even in clear medium. But then if we will use the scattering sample, you see this ratio is changing dramatically. And these are images shown for those beads with the imaging depth. You can see that at certain point, the images start to disappear in the EPI detector, while the diver still can get the decent imaging in pretty, you know, high depth, few millimeters. For example, for this sample, which is simulating scattering properties of the brain tissue, at the imaging depth of about 2 millimeters, with the diver, we had the signal gain compared to the EPI detection about 650 times, which is pretty good result. So here, the same experiment we did with the brain tissue. I mean, we imaged this tissue with the diver and the EPI detector. And you can see that also with the EPI detector, the images practically disappear after about 400, 500 microns depth. We couldn't see anything, while the diver detector still produce pretty bright images. also, you can see here that it, let's say the surface, the very shallow depth, the image is very sharp. But when we go deeper and deeper and deeper, the image becoming blurred. And this is exactly because of this effect I was telling before, the distortion of the wavefront of the excitation beam. So we were using in our system also the adaptive optics technique, which to some extent improved this imaging in the depth. So this is the picture of this deformable mirror we were using. Okay, and as I said, the diver microscope, our diver microscope also equipped with the FLIM imaging capability. So we can do fluorescence lifetime imaging and then reconstruct our samples in 3D, in pretty high depth, and you can see this is, for example, just intensity images, which doesn't show much, but if we can use our FLIM analysis, we can color those features according to lifetime, and you can see that, for example, in mouse eye embryo eye, we can highlight a lot of different features by the lifetime. Okay, as you can see that the diver microscope or diver detection is has the transmission geometry. So we do excitation on the one side of the sample and pick up the photons, fluorescence photons from another side of the sample. And this has happened to be extremely very good for harmonic generation images, imaging, such as, for example, second harmonic generation. This is the process when the light of the, let's say, wavelength lambda interact with the molecules, and in turn it will produce the exactly half of the wavelengths, another photons, right? So if we have, for example, like 800 nanometers light, it will be 400 nanometers blue light. Second harmonic generation naturally propagates in the same direction as the excitation light. So this diver detector, which is in transmission geometry, happened to be very sensitive to and very good to detect those harmonic generation photons. Well, not all the molecules will generate second harmonic, but it needs some special structure. But in biological tissues, for example, very good objects to image by second harmonic generation is like collagen fibers, and collagen is almost everywhere in all the biological tissues you can meet. Also, like muscles, nerves will generate pretty strong second harmonic signal, so we can image them. And here's just examples when we were using with the diver this second harmonic generation imaging, for example, on the muscles, very nice imaging. These are collagen fibers. We use it, for example, in the some project we had for kidney fibrosis, and you can see very nice images of the fibrotic and normal tissue in the mice kidney. And this diver detector is about three orders of magnitude much more sensitive than the conventional epidetector, if you will try to use it for detection of the second harmonic photons, then only a tiny fraction will go to epidetector because most of them propagate in the same direction, right? And the diver, which is in transmission geometry, is much, much more sensitive tool to do harmonic generation imaging. Another is, for example, third harmonic generation. This is when we have the one third of the wavelengths. For example, if we do excitation with, let's say, 900 nanometers, then third harmonic will be 300 nanometers, which is UV light, right? It's also propagate in forward direction. So it means diver would be very sensitive to these photons. Third harmonic generation imaging technique is good, for example, to image lipid droplets, cell membranes. It's usually happened on the interface between two medium. You need the very sharp index change for that. So, but because it's one third of the original wavelengths, right? It's, let's say, 900 nanometers infrared light, but we have in turn very blue in almost 300 nanometers UV light. You can detect it with the regular microscopes, but it's not very easy because optics usually designed for some visible light or even red light. So you need some special optics which will transmit this UV light. So usually when people doing third harmonic generation imaging, they are using very long excitation wavelengths. But you need for that some special lasers, which are expensive and not really easily available in the laboratories. But with the diver, which is has the response, the spectral response from like 300 nanometers to 700 nanometers. It's a very simple device, as I mentioned above, and doesn't have much optics. So with the diver detector, we can easily pick up even UV light, and we can use the standard like titanium sapphire lasers to do third harmonic generation imaging. And here's an example of such an imaging. For example, here we did, when we did diabetic studies, that's a liver fat and non-fat liver. You can see these fat droplets. Here's also images of adipose tissue, and you can see like cell membranes. These are borders between two cells. So these are sciatic nerve. Even we did images of bacteria with third harmonic generations. Here's a few images of the bacteria. So very nice technique, which is available with the diver detector and the standard excitation laser. Okay, in conclusion, it's we can also do hyperspectral images with the diver by using those special sine, cosine, and linear filters technique. This will be the subject for the talk of Belén Tarada, so I will not talk much about this. So she will give you more details. Because diver microscope can do imaging in scattering media, and using this technique, we can do hyperspectral images in highly scattering media, which is also not a trivial task, and that's a very nice feature of the diver. And this is basically all I wanted to talk.